Kind thanks go to Brilliant for sponsoring today's episode. Today, amongst other things, I'll explain to you what SpaceX's Starship has to do with the number 553 and how SpaceX might be able to fund raising the number.
What about it? Go for launch.
We're go for launch, let's light this candle.
Ignition sequence start.
My name is Felix and I am your host for today's episode of What About It. And as always, there has been a lot going on in the space industry lately, so let's dive right in. We're on the final stretch to 100,000 subscribers for the channel, and I am extremely excited that there are so many others out there interested in what SpaceX is doing. If the plan works and Starship takes off, it will most likely not only change the world of those already following the progress, but also many of those who might still not be aware of what's happening down in Boca Chica, Texas. If it turns out to be a working solution, Starships will change one fundamental aspect of spaceflight. For the first time in human history, they will make it cheap, affordable, maybe most importantly feasible for other things than science missions. Right now, the ISS is a very expensive undertaking with a price tag of around $150 billion. The people on board are the best of the best, handpicked from a very fortunate and very small elite, highly trained specialists. Growing up in the space shuttle era, the term astronaut for me and many others might be slightly misleading. I grew up thinking that you need to be one of those highly trained people to actually be able to do the trip. That you need to be that sort of super scientist slash heroic soldier to be able to get access to space. And that is true even today with very few exceptions. What can be easily misunderstood though is the fact that you don't need to be that kind of person to do a trip to space. The real reason why we're only sending athletic super geniuses is because we still need to make it count. Every minute spent up there is extremely expensive, with the cost of a seat into orbit ranging from $55 million to almost $100 million. So naturally, you'd only send those who can make the most of it. 553. What does the number stand for? That's all the astronauts. That's every single person who ever made it into orbit since Yuri Alexeyevich Gagarin, since April 12, 1961. If Starships make it into orbit and if the program keeps up with the set goals, this number will double every few months, not every 60 years like in the past. And in return, this will open up space for normal people. For us, for construction workers, nurses, prospectors, engineers, all of them not having to be some kind of a superhero, because there will be plenty of seats and the tickets will be much cheaper. Now that you know the reason why Starships are so important for all of us, let's look at what's happened since the last episode. At the construction site, one project is dominating everything else right now. The giant high bay, to be 81 meters tall when finished, is growing further and further. As seen on Le Padre's stream here, SpaceX has so far finished 4 levels and is now on what seems to be the final stretch. It probably won't take much longer to finish the construction. Maybe another week? Maybe another 2 weeks? This, in theory, of course, would mean that we could see first super heavy segments to be produced and stacked inside the high bay as soon as the end of September. This in return could mean that we can see first super heavy prototypes on the test stand by the end of the year. At least for pressure testing. That would be quite the Christmas present. Mary, aka Boca Chica Girl, has taken a beautiful picture of the final stint of high bay construction for NASASpaceflight.com. Here we can see a good estimate of how much taller the new high bay is compared to the older mid bay. It will not only be perfect for super heavy, but also for full assembly of Starships. They will easily fit in, and this gives SpaceX the perfect environment to go for the next level of quality needed for orbital flights. If we zoom in a bit closer on the top of the high bay, we can see the last half level being installed right now. After this, SpaceX will finish it with a roof. Another great picture out of Mary's camera shows the backside of the construction. Here we can see large scaffolding going up. SpaceX is closing the walls. Respect to the SpaceX workers who are up there as if it was nothing. Yet another awesome picture, this time from Carlos Nunes for Space Intelligence, shows a close-up view of what looks like possible window frames. SpaceX is flashing out the mammoth building, getting it ready for use. Close by the high bay construction site in front of the large construction tent, SpaceX is working on segments for Starship serial number 9 already, while serial number 8 is still being stacked. Just the usual fast SpaceX progress. What's interesting about Starship serial number 9's forward dome segment, besides just visually looking much cleaner and built better again, are the little dots on the right side of the hull segment. Looking much closer, we can see that those actually are little pins, and they're intended to hold heat shield tiles. Three for each tile. We've seen the use of heat tiles on Starship prototypes before, but never at such a scale. It looks like half the site will be covered with them, and the pins have been placed with great precision. Mary was lucky to take this shot through an open door of one of the larger construction tents. It shows a robot placing the pins. What's interesting about this robot is that it's almost exactly the same model manufacturing Tesla Model 3s. Yet again, SpaceX is using proven tech from Tesla and combines it with Starship construction. If mass production is to be achieved, SpaceX will have to build Starships this way, as already theorized on episode 78, if you want to get deeper into the subject. What you're looking at here is a nose cone segment. It's unknown which Starship it is for, if it's even going to be used for any prototype, but there's one feature that sticks out immediately. Triangular clamps. It's one of those pictures I've been staring at for quite some time, and I can't really come up with anything. So maybe you can help me find out what those clamps are for. Tell me in the comments what your idea is. Let's figure it out together. Liked the update so far? Then click the like button, subscribe to the channel, and maybe even consider becoming a patron to give some vital support. Link is in the description. The team is working relentlessly to provide you with updates twice a week, thanks to SpaceX's mind-boggling speed, and with your support it will be much easier in the future. Thank you. Next, let's do a flight down from the shipyard to the launch site. Awesome job by Alex Rex again, thank you for lending it to me, much appreciated. Follow him on Twitter and make sure to subscribe to his channel for more 3D flybys. We're following High Bay 4 down to the beach, where SpaceX has entered the flight phase of Starship prototype development by now. Serial number 6 is sitting on the pad waiting for its flight, and it recently received a mass simulator. Basically just two rolls of stainless steel on top of the prototype, simulating the approximately 22 tons of extra mass a nose cone would add to the prototype. A crude and cheap construction, but it does the job. The new test stand, sitting next to serial number 6, recently received a thrust simulator. Consisting of large hydraulic presses, it simulates Raptor engine thrust under a prototype while pressure tests are conducted. My guess right now is that the 7.1 test tank to test the new 304 stainless steel alloy will be put under pressure here right after the serial number 6 hop. It might also test a new thrust puck design, which for the first time includes the methane outlets on the puck itself. Before, the CH4 outlets were located on the dome, and Musk stated that he was not happy with up to 4 layers of reinforcement in some areas of the puck. Speaking of the serial number 6 hop, there are some changes with the current announced test dates. As of recording the episode, August 28th, today's primary test date for a serial number 6 hop, was cancelled. The two backup dates are still in place though, fingers crossed we might see another Starship hop on August 29th or 30th. SpaceX is progressing full steam ahead into a new age of spaceflight. Remember the number I talked about in the beginning? 553. If all goes well, the next few years will double or even triple this number, changing the world in the process. Starlink update. Next up, I want to talk about SpaceX's Starlink project. What's the status? How will it work? When can we expect service? Let's tackle some of the questions together. On August 18th, SpaceX launched yet another batch of Starlink satellites into orbit, raising the total number of the mega constellation up to 653 satellites. We're still far away from the proposed 12,000 satellites to be in orbit when the constellation is finished, but it is already the biggest satellite constellation ever constructed by far, not speaking of a possible extension to 40,000 satellites later on. When talking about SpaceX's project, the word revolutionary is always part of the topic. Basically nothing they do is completely traditional. The same goes for Starlink satellites. Erik Korshammar was so kind to make some 3D renders of Starlink satellites for today's episode. Go check him out on Twitter and make sure to give him a follow for his awesome contribution. So this is it, a Starlink satellite. A very basic construction for a reason. It's supposed to be very cheap. Manufacturing one costs SpaceX round about $300,000. That might sound like a lot, especially when considering the number of satellites, but it actually isn't. Let's compare it to a typical internet communication satellite. Let's take the Telesat NX-G1 for comparison, as it's one of the latest additions to the space-based internet satellites. Weight: 4,905 kilograms. Estimated price: $450 million. Operational life: 15 years. Position: geostationary. Average latency: 638 milliseconds. Max uplink: 3 Mbit per second. Max downlink: 30 Mbit per second. Average service cost per month: round about $100. Now let's see some numbers for Starlink. Weight: 260 kilograms. Estimated price: $300,000. Operational life: 5 years. Position: low Earth orbit. Now for average speeds, we'll use some speed tests that recently surfaced. Average latency, if we take the 8 ping numbers and calculate the average, would be almost precisely 50 milliseconds. That's more than 12 times faster than traditional SAT-based internet and even suitable for online gaming, as Musk stated before. Average uplink using the same method would be 12.47 Mbit. To put it into perspective, that's more than 4 times the uplink bandwidth of Viasat, one of the largest satellite internet providers. Average downlink then would be 45.19 Mbit, which is again about 1.5 times the bandwidth of Viasat. Average service cost, according to Gwynne Shotwell, COO of SpaceX, will be around $80 per month. These numbers leave no doubt about the superiority of Starlink pretty much in every way. Besides being much cheaper to launch with much faster internet speed and latency, Starlink will also be able to cover almost the entire planet once fully developed. Right now, SpaceX is massively ramping up the numbers of satellites in orbit. 3 more launches are planned for the next 4 weeks, getting the number up by roughly another 180 satellites. This is what a Starlink antenna looks like. It's a so-called phased array antenna, meaning that it's not just one antenna, but hundreds in an array capable of focusing the beam on moving satellites in the night sky without moving at all. So it won't have to mechanically track passing satellites. As long as there are satellites in line of sight, the system has reception. Combined with an end-user terminal, a Starlink router so to speak, the system will be extremely easy to set up as well. Place the antenna anywhere it has a view of the sky, plug in cables and connect to terminal, done. The rest is done internally by the system and you're good to go. Starlink won't just be interesting for home users though. It will be available anywhere on the planet, remember? Ships, planes, remote locations, military, all of them will be able to get a very cheap and easy to utilize broadband internet connection almost anywhere on the planet. And all of it ties into the Starship program as well. If Elon Musk and SpaceX want to turn their plan of colonizing Mars into reality, they will need funding. Lots of funding. Starlink is supposed to play a major role in this. Forbes, for example, estimated a market value by 2025 of around $30 billion, with a revenue of around $10.4 billion. That's an insane amount of money available for Starship development and production. Feeling a bit more confident that SpaceX can actually get the Mars colony going? 553. Musk and SpaceX have a very detailed and smart plan of raising that number. And with a little luck, we're in for a heck of a ride in the next few decades. If you want to tackle great things, you need to work on more than one side of the problem. You need to have multiple talents and know more than just one topic. But how to do it yourself? How to know all of it to get your own great dream done? Today's sponsor might be able to help you here. Brilliant is a problem-solving based website and app with a hands-on approach with over 60 interactive courses in math, science, and computer science. Brilliant helps you to achieve your goals in STEM, starting with one small commitment to learn and build up to a long-term challenge and growth. One brand new course on Brilliant, for example, tackles the topic of uncertainty. This course gives you mathematical tools for dealing with the flood of information in our lives. For example, can you put a number on how much you don't know? Sure you can. And when you learn something new, how should it change your beliefs about how the world works? Is there some sort of formula for that? Why, yes, there is. This is just one example of all the courses on Brilliant. Brilliant puzzles you, surprises you, and expands your understanding of the modern world. All of Brilliant's courses have storytelling, code writing, interactive challenges, and problems to solve. To learn things the Brilliant way and at the same time support What About It, go to brilliant.org/whataboutit and sign up to try out over 60 interactive courses for free. And if you choose to get the premium subscription, the first 200 people to join through the link will get 20% off the annual premium subscription. Learn things the Brilliant way. Links in the description. And we're at the Patreon and YouTube member shoutout again. Today I want to give a special shoutout to Decula03, John P. Salvaggio, Kent Anderson, Stefano, Jonathan Jarvis, Jeff Myers, and many others. You rock! Those people give their money for something completely free and in return enable me and my team to go that step further every time. Thank you so much, and don't forget to link your Discord accounts in the Patreon account settings for patrons or the YouTube account in your Discord app for YouTube members to gain access to our Discord and talk to me in person. Last but certainly not least, here's my shout out to the most awesome team of people in the world, my team. Thank you all so much for research, scripting, proofreading, animations, company, jokes, and thousands of other little things. You rock. A roundabout. Do you know that saying with Darth Vader and the GPS navigation system, and he says roundabout. Turn round at the roundabout. I'll get there.